Homework Hotline is supported in part by New York State United Teachers. NYSUT's 600,000 members are building a brighter future in New York State classrooms, universities, and healthcare facilities. NYSUT, a union of professionals. And by viewers like you.
And welcome to a new season of Homework Hotline. I'm Joe Zuniga.
And I'm Laura Drake. Homework Hotline is the place where you can get help with your homework on the phone, online, or on TV.
Now, here's how it works. Teachers from Dallas Teachers standing by right now to take your call and help you with your homework.
So if you'd like help with your homework, call Dial a Teacher free at 888-986-2345.
Now you can also send your questions to us at our website, homeworkhotline.org. Just click on the Yak Back button and send in your questions. All right, now before we get started tonight, we'd like to take a minute to talk about a few announcements. We have a few new and exciting things going on at Homework Hotline. The first thing is our new website that we just mentioned, so make sure you go to homeworkhotline.org and see what's new. We also have made it easier for you to find videos to help you with your homework.
Also this year, we, the Homework Hotline teachers, are going to get some help from students. A little later, we'll meet Michaela and Nicole. They're going to help us on set, and they'll be appearing in some of our segments and health and careers.
All right, now the last thing we have to announce is new prizes for the Hotline Hall of Fame this year. Homework Hotline will be giving away 3 tablets at the end of the season. Now, we'll also be splitting the Hall of Fame to 3 different age ranges, so one person from each age range will win a tablet. Check out the updated Hall of Fame on our website, homeworkhotline.org.
Now, let's get to tonight's creature teaser so you can earn those points. Okay, this mammal in tonight's creature teaser loves the water. In order for this creature to keep their large body cool, they'll keep it submerged in the water for up to 16 hours a day. Now, this might be why the Greeks named this animal the water horse. They can also breathe for up to 5 minutes underwater, and they're really good swimmers.
All right, but don't be fooled, because this animal does like to lay in the sun on the shoreline. In order to protect themselves from the African sun, this creature secretes a red oil-like substance, and this may have led to the myth that this animal sweats blood.
So, if you think you can solve this creature teaser, give our hotline a call at 1-866-264-5904. Or you can just answer it on our website, homeworkhotline.org. Answer correctly, and you could have a chance to share the answer at the end of the show.
All right, but every correct response we had at our Hotline Hall of Fame earned enough points, and you could win a tablet at the end of the season. All right, now it's time for some homework. And you have a review question for us?
Well, I have a question that's pretty popular. A couple of kids have done it at my school, and I've had some other people call me up, so I'm going to go do this question over at the board.
Okay.
It is a seventh grade question on ratio and proportions, and I know a lot of kids in seventh grade are doing a lot of work with ratio and proportions. So this problem says, at Euclid Middle School, of the 30 girls who tried out for the lacrosse team, 12 were selected, and of the 40 boys who tried out, 16 were selected. Are the ratios of numbers of students of the team to number of students trying out the same for girls and boys? And how do you know? And we kind of talked about this with my class about, well, did the boys have an easier time getting on the team, or did the girls have an easier time getting on the team? When we look at the numbers, there were only 30 girls trying out, and I see that right here, but only 12 of them actually got on the team. The boys had more people trying out. They had 40 boys trying out, but they were willing to take a few more guys on the team. So which one was easier to get onto, the girls' team or the boys' team? So when they asked the question here that they said, is the ratio of students the same? We can try and figure out who's got a higher ratio or a lower ratio to figure out which team is the easiest one to get on. So I'm going to use a ratio table real fast. And we've got the girls, and we've got the boys. Oh, we've got the girls. Sorry, we've got the students. I'm sorry. The number of students. And we're not going to compare the girls to the boys. We want to compare the amount of students trying out to the amount of students who made the team. So this is students who tried out. And these are kids who got to be on the team, who made the team. All right. So let's take the information that we have, and we're going to throw that into the table. This is pretty messy, but that's okay. Sometimes math gets messy. So the first thing, the number of students who tried out, we have got the girls tried out. So we have 30 girls tried out, but only 12 girls made the team. And for the boys, let's label that as girls right there. For the boys, when I look up in my information up here, I see that you had 40 boys who tried out, but only 16 were selected. You're like, okay, I've got all my information in the table, and that's a great way to get organized. Otherwise, some of these problems are really overwhelming. All this information is all right here in the table, and it's definitely a lot easier to work with. So the next thing that we want to do is we want to come up with a ratio. Why do we want to come up with a ratio? Because the question says, are the ratio of the numbers of students the same for the boys and the girls? So let's set it up as a ratio. So when we do a ratio, we're going to compare the first number to the second number. And there's a couple of different ways to write a ratio. Over here, I'm going to show you. You can write a ratio as A to B, like this. Sometimes your teacher may have you write it as A with the word to B. And sometimes we write it as a fraction. A over B. So I'm going to write it as a fraction because in seventh grade that kind of makes life a lot easier when we write them as fractions. So we're going to write this ratio as 30 over 12. So what that means is for every 30 boys that made the, sorry, for every 30 girls that tried out, 12 girls made the team. And on this one, for every 40 boys that tried out, 16 made the team. So now we want to find out if they're equivalent ratios. And the easiest way to compare ratios is if we could get them to be the same. So we're going to reduce these ratios down. So if I take 30 over 12 and I want to reduce it as much as I can, 30 and 12, they're both even numbers. I know that the number 2 at least will go into it. So maybe we could reduce it that way. And we get 15 over 6. And I'm looking at that and that's not good enough because I think that I can break that down again. And I know that the number 3 goes into both of them. And we get 5 over 2. Okay? So the ratio is for every 5 girls who tried out, only 2 of them made the team. Let's see what happens with the boys. When I take the boys and I break that down, I see they're even. I do 20 over 8. And I could break that one down again because I know the number 4 goes into both of those. 20 goes into 4 5 times and 20 go, 4 goes into 8 2 times. So when I look at the ratio, when we reduce them, we both have the same ratio of 5 over 2. So the question is, you know, which ratio are the ratios of the number of the teams of the students trying out the same for the girls and the boys? And they are the same. So the boys didn't have an easier time than the girls, and the girls didn't have an easier time than the boys did. They both had the same ratio of times trying to get on the team. That was a great, hard question.
I said, hey.
Need help with your homework? Find the number for where you live and then make the call.
Okay, we got another question. Now, this one is off of an old eighth grade state test, but I'm also going to talk about what the earth science students will be studying this year going into it, because they're going to go into this problem with a greater detail. So if we go to the board here, this is a picture of the moon, okay, and it says the photograph below shows phases of the moon as seen by an observer in New York State, okay? So we have this one here, but then there are four different phases, and we're going to talk about what those are in a minute. But the question says, which phase is closest what be seen by the observer in New York State 1 month later? Now that's a key thing, that word month comes from moon. And so if we look at the phases of the moon, that means from, for example, this one here is a full moon, to go from one full moon to the next full moon is about 29 and a half days. Basically what we think of as a month. So that's kind of giving the answer right away. If we go from one phase to the same phase again, it's about a month later, about 29 and a half days, all right? But I thought we'd look at some of these other questions here, phases that are shown here, and talk a little bit about what they are, and talk about this because when you get to earth science, you're going to go in these phases of the moon in more detail. Now, if we look at this one here, okay, and this one here, they look similar, but if you notice, a little bit less of this one is illuminated than this one, and this one, about half of it's illuminated, all right? Here's our full moon. This was our correct answer number 3, because that's what we'll see again in a month. And over here, we've got almost a full moon, but part of it's not illuminated here. And that's the key thing here, because notice on 1 and 2, the left half of the moon is illuminated, the right half is kind of dark. On number 4 there, notice it's the right part of the moon that's illuminated, and the left part is dark. And that's important, because that tells us whether the moon is waxing, getting brighter, or waning, getting less illuminated through the month. So let's look at this one, number two here. The left side of the moon is being illuminated, and this would be what we would call the last quarter. It's a little mnemonic to remember. They say, is the light on the right, moon getting bright. So as the moon's getting brighter from new moon, when we don't see the moon at all, to the full moon, which would be about half a month, we would see the right side of the moon progressively getting brighter. And so this stage here, number four, this gibbous moon, would be just before full moon. Okay, that's almost completely illuminated. Now it's kind of funny that we call, when half the moon is, we see the whole illuminated side, we call a full moon. That's only half the moon that's illuminated, and we call this one a quarter when it's really half of that, half of a full. But that's the way we do it. So when it's illuminated on the left, this would be the last quarter. If this was flipped around, illuminated on the right, it would be the first quarter, and here we have a crescent. Okay, so earth science students, you'll get in those in more detail, and we'll look at this later on in the year. We'll look at some diagrams and see what causes those phases.
I said, hey, hey.
King Henry died drinking chocolate milk. This silly sentence, called a mnemonic device or a memory tool, can help you remember the order for converting to the metric system. Kilo times 1,000, hecto times 100, deca times 10, deci times 0.1, centi times 0.01, milli times 0.001.
All right, we'll get back to the homework in just a minute, but tonight, in tonight's Zoofily, we head to the Seneca Park Zoo here in Rochester, New York, to find out more about the river otter. Take a look.
The scientific name for the river otter is Lantra canadensis. We have four river otters here at the Seneca Park Zoo. We have our two males, who are six, Skipper and Sailor, they're brothers. And we have our two females, Sarah and Heather, who are 10. Otters belong to the weasel family, also known as the mustelids family, which also has included the weasels, minks, polecats, badgers. And they all have round ears, in general, a short, elongated body with small limbs. Otters are built for to swim in the water quite well. They have several adaptations that allow that. One is their streamlined body. It allows for agility in the water. They have a large, thick, muscular tail, which acts as a rudder and uses for stability. And they have webbed feet, which is perfect for swimming. Their nostrils can close, and a transparent lid goes over their eyes so they can see underwater. There are 13 different types of otters. The thing that makes them different is their buildup. You have the Asian small clawed otter, that's the little smallest otter that there is, and then the giant otter in Brazil, who could be up to 6 feet long. You have the hairy nose otter, the smooth-coated otter, otters that are purely marine, which are the sea otters. So they're all different types of otters for different locations, and they have different buildups for those areas. You would find river otters through most of Canada. They're in all the provinces. Alaska, along the northwestern coast, along east and southeast of America, and around the Great Lakes region. You might be able to find an otter in your backyard if you have a secluded area with woods, a nice pond, river, or stream estuary that has denning options for them. It might be possible to see them then. River otters eat a variety of things, including fish, and crayfish is their main part of the diet, but they're also known to eat clams, salamanders, frogs, small reptiles, small mammals, and even birds. River otter can slide on the ground when there's snow and ice. They can, it's a means for travel for them. They can travel a lot quicker by doing so. And what they do is they get a running start, and then they'll tuck their front limbs at their sides, and then their back limbs are out back, and they'll slide on their belly. And they also use this as a way of play, so it's mostly in the snow or ice, but they can also use wet grass or mud to slide down into the water.
Yeah.
All right, now, if you want to see this segment again or go to others like it, go to our website, homeworkonline.org, and click on More Videos. And now you have another question for us? Another review question? On equivalent ratios, was it?
I do.
All right.
Okay. So I'm going to go on up there. And we have, I know a big part, again, ratio and proportions. Let's stick with some ratio and proportions. And a big question might be, can you write equivalent ratios? Okay. So we're looking for things that are equivalent ratios. Okay. So we have equivalent ratios. And when we talk about equivalent ratios, those are equations that are kind of equal, and you see that kind of equal in the beginning, that means the same. So we did some equivalent ratios in the last problem. When we reduced that ratio and we brought it down, we brought it down, we brought it down, all those were the same way of saying the same thing. It's kind of like reducing fractions, if that would help you to think about it. So if I want to come with equivalent ratios to the number 4 over 20, that means if we did the lacrosse problem, you know, 4 girls made the team out of 20, or if you're in a classroom, there are 4 boys for every 20 girls. And we want to find out what would be equivalent if we had a bigger pool of people or a smaller pool of people. So there's a couple quick ways to do this one. One is that you can just kind of like double the numbers, and then we know that that would be equivalent. So I know 4 over 20 is the same thing as 8 over 40. How'd you get that, right? You're saying, well, I thought in my head that I'm going to multiply the top by 2, and I'm kind of multiplying the bottom by 2, and that gets me 8 over 40. So one important thing to know when you're finding an equivalent ratio, and they said, how did you get it? You can't say I multiplied 4 over 20 by the number 2, because if you multiply something by the number 2, you're not going to have the same value. We're saying that these are equal. So it's really important to know that when you multiply by a ratio and you're trying to describe how you did it, you multiplied it by 2 over 2. I'm going to put that on the side. You're multiplying it by the number 2 over 2, which is the number 1. Which means that it's got the same value. So let's try and come up with another one. Besides doubling it, sometimes you can look, and if you see they have a common factor, you can kind of divide by it. And since they're both even, I know that 2 goes into it, and this is kind of like the problem we did earlier. It's the same thing. I'm going to take the 4, and I'm going to divide it by 2, and I'm going to get the number 2. And I'm going to take the number 10, and I'm going to divide it by 2. I'm going to divide 20 by 2, and I'm going to get the number 10. And these are all equivalent. They're all the same comparison. If I was making a recipe and I needed 4 cups of water to 20 cups of juice, I would do the same if I was making a bigger batch. And if I was cutting the recipe in half, I would use the other one. So these are all equivalent ratios.
This country is the only one in the world that covers an entire continent. It is also one of the largest countries on Earth. This place has a lot of natural resources and fertile land, but more than one-third is covered in desert. The platypus, kangaroo, and koala all call this place home. Since the Australian outback, a famous region containing deserts with scorching temperatures and very little water, covers so much of the land, many of the Australian cities and farms are located in the southern portion of the country. Australia has one of the most unusual ecosystems in the world. Many of the animal species found here are not found anywhere else in the world. There are over 500 national parks in Australia to help protect the unique plants and animals.
So now we'd like to take a minute and introduce some new faces to Hotline. Today we have with us Michaela and Nicole.
Well, welcome, ladies.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Now tell us, what are some things you've been doing on Hotline?
Well, we were both in the skateboarding segment recently, and that was very cool.
Yeah, one of the Homework Hotline crew members, Jimmy, was actually used to be a professional skateboarder, so he was teaching us some of the cool moves and everything that we could do on a skateboard.
Oh, cool.
Yeah.
I wouldn't do it. I'd fall and get hurt.
We did. Yeah, we did a couple of times.
No broken bones?
No.
No.
Yeah. Well, tell us a little about your school lives, your extracurriculars.
I'm a part of Rotary Interact Club. I do the musical and the play at my school, and I do the morning show.
Wow, so this is nothing for you being in front of the camera. You're used to it, right? Nice job. And you?
I do all the shows at my school, and I do some shows outside of my school, and I take dance lessons, and I ski in the winter time.
When do you find time to skateboard?
We can try.
You sound busy. Yeah.
So in school, you guys good students?
I'd like to say so. I'm a high honor roll with distinction. So
yeah. Oh, good.
So what subjects do you guys enjoy?
I definitely love English this year. I have the best teacher, and I also love chorale, which is our chorus.
Oh, good.
Yeah, I really love social studies a lot. I don't know, I just really like learning about history and all of that, and I also really like music and choir.
Well, that's great. So the right answer was science was your favorite.
Yeah.
Well, no, that's great, because you gotta like what you like.
And
everybody's different.
What grade are you girls in?
I'm in 10th.
And I'm in 9th.
Great, great. Well, we're going to have you with us all year. It's going to be great. You guys are going to be doing different things, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah. All right. All right. What made you decide to do this?
Well, I've always loved acting, and I really wanted to try dabbling into television and, like, movies. And so I saw this audition, and I thought it was an amazing opportunity, so I auditioned.
That's great. And how about you?
Well, yeah, I do a lot of theater and everything, and I've done a few movies before and a few commercials. So, like, this was looked like really fun because I like being behind the camera and everything.
Hmm. Good. And so, is this your... I mean, go ahead.
I was just going to ask, did you guys watch Hotline before?
I've seen it a couple times.
Yeah, I've seen a few episodes.
Did you ever call up for help before?
No.
No?
Didn't need it, huh?
No.
Yeah. Now, what's your career plans? Are you thinking of going into theater, acting? Or?
I really want to go into film production.
Yeah?
Yeah.
Well, that's great. See, are you seeing some of the behind-the-scenes things here? Great.
Awesome. And so, like you said, you've done some commercials. Would it be a commercial that we would actually see here in Rochester?
Well, I haven't done something like that for a long time, but I did, like, a car commercial before with Bob Johnson Chevrolet and a few things like that.
Aren't you a little too young to be driving a car?
A little bit.
Yeah. But you're still there. That's great.
Yeah.
And what do you want to go into?
I don't know. I think it would be really cool to go into theater, but I'm still not sure.
Yeah. You know, there's a lot of opportunities out there, you know, besides just the acting part. You said you see the behind the scenes. You see how many people it takes to put this show on. It's, well, a whole lot more than us two that you see up here, isn't it?
Yeah.
That's cool.
So you guys were working all summer to film some of the clips that we've guys have had?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. In the middle of the summer, I worked on a yoga clip before with some of the other Homework Hotline people, and that was a lot of fun. And just last week, I did a segment on the Firefighter Explorer program over at the North Greece fireplace.
Very cool.
So what was the most unusual thing you guys have come across?
I never knew disc golf existed, and we did a disc golf segment.
Okay.
And so that was really cool. Plus, I saw one of the disc golf baskets. I don't know what they're called exactly. And I knew what it was, so I was really happy about that.
Very cool.
That's great.
Yeah.
So what do you guys do for hobbies? How do you keep yourself fit? So you said that you guys do, you act and that you dance. What are the kind of activities do you guys keep yourself busy
with? I take voice.
Okay.
School's keeping me pretty busy. And, yeah, that's about it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I take voice and I dance and I ski in the winter and everything.
Now, you guys have such similar, you know, things that you're, did you know each other before this?
Yeah, we met at a... camp.
Yeah, we've done a few things together before, so that's
very cool.
Exciting.
Did you know you were trying out together, or did you
have no? I had no idea.
No.
Well, it worked out well, didn't it?
And how about the other hosts? Do you guys ever, do you know any of the other students?
I do.
Student?
Yeah, we've done things with a couple of the other ones, like Kervin, who was here yesterday,
and Adriana.
Mm-hmm. And Calvin, he will probably be on soon. He used to go to school with me, too, so that's cool.
Very cool.
So you'll have to give us some of their secrets maybe one day.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. All right. Well, it's great having you guys with us, and glad you're going to be with us all year.
All right.
But now, I think we have a winner in tonight's creature teaser. Hello, Faith. Are you there? Hello?
Hello?
Hi. Who's this?
Faith.
Hi, Faith. And what grade are you in?
Third grade.
Third grade. What's our answer, Faith?
What?
What's the answer?
The hippopotamus.
Hippopotamus,
ooh,
very
awesome.
Good. Yeah. How did what's the hint that gave it away to you?
What?
What hint gave it away to you? How did you come up with the answer?
My mom Googled it and we found the after I gave my mom the clue, she Googled it online and she got the answer online.
Well, very cool. Yeah, they're
and we looked it up together.
Yeah. Now, they're a big animal to think of them as spending so much time underwater, aren't they? You know, they're the second biggest land animal? Yep, only the elephant is bigger.
The hippopotamus is not the biggest land animal.
No, second biggest. You're right. They aren't the biggest. They're the second biggest. All right. You're right. You know, they're very dangerous. A lot more. It's, you know, people don't realize how often people are killed by hippos more than some of the other animals we think of as more dangerous, because they hang out underwater and people may not realize that they're there. They're very territorial. But you knew a lot. Congratulations. All right. Thanks for calling. All right, but don't forget now, every correct response goes to our Homer Kotlin Hall of Fame. Earn enough points, you can win a tablet at the end of the season.
Well, that's all the time we have for tonight. We're saying goodbye, but Dial-A-Teacher is available with free homework help on the phone until 7 o'clock tonight.
All right, good night.
Good night.
Good night.
Homework Hotline is supported in part by New York State United Teachers. NYSUT's 600,000 members are building a brighter future in New York State classrooms, universities, and healthcare facilities. NYSUT, a union of professionals, and by viewers like you.